Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us here today. My name is Katie Kross. I am Managing Director of the Center for Energy Development and the Global Environment at the Fuqua School of Business at Duke University. Really excited to have you join us today. We're talking about MBA careers and sustainability. So whether you're a current MBA student, or maybe you're an alum, or maybe you're thinking about getting an MBA, or you're just curious about what the sustainable business career options might be, hopefully this will be informative and engaging opportunity for you to learn a little bit more. We are recording today's session. So if you don't have a chance to stay for the whole thing, or you want to watch some of it afterwards, we will be posting it on YouTube afterwards. And we'll also be posting the slide deck in the YouTube summary. So you'll have a link to the slides as well. So thanks again for joining us. Just a few minutes, few words about our format today. So I will be presenting for about 30 minutes-ish, and then I will transition to Q&A. If you have a question, please go ahead and type it in the Q&A box. I will not be looking at the question part of the program, though, and then I'll be reading the questions and trying to answer as many of them as I can in that time. So please try to keep your question, you know, pretty clear and succinct. If you have a question that's very specific to your own personal unique circumstances, it's probably not something that we'll be able to get to today. But if you have a question that others on the call might have a similar question, or it's generally applicable to lots of folks, then that sounds like it would be a great opportunity for us to discuss. So I look forward to getting to your questions a little bit later after the slides. Before I start talking about careers, let me tell you a little bit more about EDGE. So EDGE is the home for all things related to energy and environmental issues as they relate to business here at the Fuqua School of Business. So Fuqua is based in Durham, North Carolina. We have a great thriving MBA program, executive MBA program. We also have several other master's degrees, and we have a joint degree between the MBA and the Master's of Environmental Management. So if any of you are interested in any of those programs, I encourage you to consider checking out our center and our program. We also have a video Q&A about energy and environment at Fuqua on our website here. You can see the link. And we have a number of career resources on our website too that you can access before or after taking a look at the program. So hope you'll have a chance to engage with us in some respects. The other resource that I would love to tell you about is a new website platform that we launched this year called MBA-EDGE. You can see the website here is mba-edge.com. And on this site, we are creating new briefings and thought leadership products that help you get up to speed on social impact and sustainability topics. So if you want to learn more about ESG investing or sustainability in business, all of these papers are aimed with a sort of MBA mindset in mind. Whether you're like prepping for an interview and you just want to get caught up to speed on what's happening in the sustainability reporting landscape or electric vehicle market, hopefully there's some content there. It's all free. You can download it. You can share it with your faculty. You can share it with your students or classmates. So hope you'll have a chance to check it out. And you can add your name to our mailing list if you want to learn more about new publications as they come out. So just a couple of resources from our end. Let's talk about careers and sustainability now. So some of you on the call today, I know, may be really in the exploring phase. Like you're interested in sustainability. You just don't really know what the job options are, what's out there. Maybe you want to learn more about the trends. So we'll talk a little bit about that. Others of you on the call, you might know exactly what you want to do, and you really want to talk more about some of the tactical strategies and resources for actually getting into the sustainability careers. So I want to talk a little bit about that as well. Hopefully there's a little bit for everyone, whether you're sort of in that exploring phase or whether you're actually into the tactical job search phase. And I'll try to at least, you know, give you a little few insights that will be helpful to your job search, no matter where you are in thinking about your career search at this point. But let's start with exploring the options and talk a little bit about the sustainability career landscape. So you probably discovered this if you're at all interested in this field. There are a lot of buzzwords out there, right? It is a pretty confusing landscape. And it's also confusing because a lot of companies use some of these terms interchangeably, some of them in different ways. You know, there's a lot happening. It's also really confusing because, you know, not a lot of the job titles have these words in their job title. So sometimes it can be a real challenge to find those jobs that are sustainability jobs if they don't say that directly in the title. Couple of takeaways for you right now. First of all, the sustainability job market writ large is booming. There are so many opportunities, and I don't say that all the time. I have been a sustainability educator for more than 15 years now, and I always have said that there are opportunities in this space, and I have always coached students to help find them opportunities in this space. But in the last year and a half, we have really seen an explosion in opportunities and what a lot of professionals are calling a war for talent right now in the sustainability space. My second takeaway for you is that there are a lot of different ways for you to take your interest in social and or environmental issues and overlay them with your business skill set. So marketing, finance, operations, strategy, supply chain, leadership, accounting, you know, you have all these functional business skills and you also have this interest in social or environmental impact. And there are many different ways to combine those that are translate into meaningful careers. That could be in a career that has one of these words in the title, but it could also be looking for ways to incorporate some of these issues like sustainability, ESG, climate tech, impact investing, conservation into a role no matter where you are in an organization. So there's a lot of different possibilities out there. I'm going to give you a few specific examples now. So first of all, you know, probably many of you have joined the call today because you've already thought about working in a corporate sustainability function. If you're interested in this, there absolutely are careers to work in the corporate sustainability department at a big company. You know, most of the Fortune 500 companies, they're producing an annual sustainability report. They have a team working on their sustainable footprint, managing their sustainability issues. Some of those companies, the team is still small, like one or two people. Others of them, you know, Nike and Amazon now have hundreds of people working in their sustainability department. So there are opportunities for that to be your job function. And the examples I'm going to give you in these next couple of slides, they are real MBAs who I know personally that are either in that job or held that job, you know, until recently. So the next takeaway for you though is like, that's not the only way to work in a sustainability career. So maybe you want to do consulting, right? You can work in a sustainability consulting oriented role for a big management consulting firm. They incidentally are all ramping up their ESG climate sustainability practices right now. Or you could work in a boutique firm that's doing specifically social impact strategy or sustainability strategy. Those are viable options as well. You might be interested in investing or have an investment background. There are lots of opportunities to work in impact investing, ESG investing, you know, mission-oriented investing. Maybe you want to work in the clean energy sector. As you probably have already gathered, you know, you can take any of those MBA skills, finance, project finance, business development, sales, marketing, and apply them within the clean energy sector. That could be in a renewable energy company. It could be in an electric vehicle or electric vehicle charging infrastructure company. Energy storage is a hot topic, or it could be within a corporate energy group. Many of the bigger companies now have teams that are specifically looking at their energy footprint, including how they procure renewable energy. So those are viable career path options as well. But we're just getting started, there's more. So if you're interested in marketing, you know, you could take that marketing skills and do marketing for a nonprofit or a mission-oriented brand, a brand that's in one of those clean energy spaces or that's in, has a B corporation that has a social benefit. You could work specifically in the nonprofit sector. If you want to do program management or investing, you could work for environmental conservation organization. You could work in one of the big NGOs that's working specifically with business on sustainability strategies. Maybe you're entrepreneurial. Clearly, there's lots of opportunities for you to start your own climate tech or sustainability related venture or to join a startup in this space. Or to join a VC firm. We'll see trends in a minute, and there's a lot of money going into climate tech VC right now. And last box here is supply chain. So if you're really oriented to supply chain operations, there are dedicated roles to working in sustainability, packaging, procurement, and supply chain operations. So those are options as well. What I really want you to take away here is that there are a lot of different possibilities to take your functional interests and your sustainability passion. And even though there are lots of postings that in the sustainability space right now, there are also a lot of other possibilities beyond that too. So think about what's going to be the best fit for you and what's going to be the most, you know, rewarding career for you, given your interests, your skills, and your passion. So let's spend a minute talking about trends. I'm sure all of you are paying attention to the news already. A few of these stories are out of date, but these are just a collection of some of the headlines from last year. We're seeing lots of different sustainability trends. So the first is that you probably noticed that most of the big corporations have been making really bold climate commitments. This started before, you know, COP26, which happened this fall, but has been continuing through on. So Microsoft in 2020 last year announced that not only is it going to set a target to be carbon negative by 2030, it's also planning to offset all of its carbon emissions in the history of the company. Similarly, other companies are making lots of pledges. They're not all as bold as that, I would say, but many of them are setting targets to become carbon neutral by 2030 or by 2050. And the scale of that, the ripple effects of that are huge, because what it's going to take for, let's say, a utility company, right, like a Duke Energy, to get to net zero carbon emissions by 2050 is huge. So companies are looking for, you know, talent for these teams, executives that are going to help them move the company to net zero. And I don't see that changing anytime soon. There's so much work to be done over the next coming decades in order to get companies to achieving those climate commitments. Clearly, we're all also paying attention to the trend that we are woefully behind in addressing racial equity, environmental justice, and diversity and inclusion issues. Not only individuals, but corporations are realizing that we have to wake up and do a lot more to not only make companies more diverse and inclusive, but for companies to play a role in making society more diverse and inclusive. So there's a lot of interest and investment going into building up DEI and environmental justice programs, and a lot of opportunity for you if you want to work on these issues. I believe it's, you know, just this week, the Bezos Earth Fund made a second round of grants. And I want to say it's in the neighborhood of $400 million new dollars going into environmental justice this week. Another big trend is clearly a sort of unabated growth in the renewable energy sector, including energy storage, you know, solar, wind, offshore wind, electric vehicles, charging infrastructure. Everything to do with decarbonizing our energy system is on the upswing right now. And clearly there's a lot of roles for you to take your MBA skills and work in one of those companies, or to work on how we decarbonize the energy system, whether you're doing that from the policy side of things, the investment side of things, the utility side of things, or, you know, the VC entrepreneurial side of things. The larger trend here is investment in climate tech. So climate tech is one of those terms that, you know, means different things to different people. You'll hear different definitions out there. Most of the investors are using the term climate tech as a pretty broad brush umbrella to include all things decarbonization. So including some of that renewable energy, electric vehicles, charging infrastructure, also to include carbon removal technology investments, other strategies for decarbonizing our economy, like smart agriculture, regenerative agriculture, nature-based climate solutions, decarbonizing strategies for decarbonizing some of the hard-to-abate sectors. So lots of money going into this space. I think the most recent article I read said that we're over $30 billion worth of investment in climate tech VC this year so far. So, and that may have even grown since the last time I read that. So it's a really hot space. And then demand for ESG investing. So I have used this term already. If you're not familiar with it, ESG is environmental, social, and governance investing. ESG is the framework that the investment community often prefers to use. You know, instead of saying sustainable investing necessarily, they use this term ESG investing. It's investing with a lens, either a filter or a proactive kind of investment in, you know, positive ESG investment strategies. So many investors have begun to realize that environmental social governance issues present real risks to businesses. So you may be following the TCFD, the Task Force on Climate-Related Financial Disclosures, and their work. You know, they are looking at how does climate risk present, you know, material risk for businesses, and recommending that investors screen for that and companies report for that too. So there's been a ton of activity in the investment community. It's hard to keep up with. We do have a paper if you want to learn more about this space. All the investment houses are hiring into ESG investment roles. And then likewise, you know, the advisory groups are too. And then the companies are often also hiring ESG roles in which a corporate executive or team is responsible for collecting that data, reporting, and setting strategy for how they report ESG outcomes to investors. So there's a lot happening. Hopefully there's a lot for you to find excitement in, find your niche in, find your particular passion area. Oh, and also I can't forget the circular economy. It's another hot topic. So if this is not one that you're familiar with, this is really top of mind for many of the consumer goods companies and the apparel companies. But circular economy refers to, instead of a linear supply chain, so a linear supply chain would go from raw materials, manufacturing, sale of the product, consumer use, and then landfill at end of life. Circular economy asks, you know, how can we take the landfill out of that equation, take the product through that cycle, and bring it back into reuse or upcycling or recycling back into raw materials and make that a closed loop system or circular economy. Lots happening on that front too. In particular, we're seeing some new legislation, especially out of Europe, looking at, you know, producers' responsibility for end of life. There's been a lot, obviously, on plastics. I'm sure you've heard the pushback on plastics, and a lot of companies are thinking about, you know, how can we reduce waste of products at their end of life? And they're hiring for roles that do say manager of circular economy. So it's pretty interesting. This is, a lot of these roles are brand new for the very first time, you know, have never been created before. So they're going to be entrepreneurial, whether they're in a startup or not. So let me give you a few tools for thinking about some of these options. I kind of threw a lot at you. There's a lot happening in the landscape right now, but there are some strategies for how you think about where you want to fit into the sustainability career landscape. So the first is pretty simple, 5 questions to ask yourself. And these are questions that I ask our students when they come in and want to talk about their job search strategy. This is the place where we start. The first is, what's the impact area that you're passionate about, right? Is it climate? Is it education? Is it poverty alleviation? Is it environmental justice? Is it, you know, plant alternative proteins? What's that change that you would like to see in the world that you're passionate about? I think it's really important to start with this question so that you can anchor your job search into the piece of this equation that's meaningful to you in terms of being a change agent. The second question is, what sector do you want to do that from? So do you want to work in the nonprofit, government? Do you want to work in the private sector? If the private sector, do you want to work in a large company, a small company, a B corporation, that's a for-benefit company, a startup? You know, really, it's about fit, what kind of culture you like, and where you think you will thrive. Third question is industry. Sometimes industry does overlap with impact area, but not always. Like renewable energy might be the impact area that you want to work on, and it's also an industry. But the alternative might be to say that you want to work on, you know, climate or water from within the consumer goods industry, or from within, you know, the aviation industry. And this is important to think through if you want, especially if you want to work in a corporate sustainability function, because the sustainability issues that a team works on, they vary greatly from industry to industry. So the sustainability team at Levi Strauss might be working on different priorities than the sustainability team at Bank of America or JetBlue or Alcoa. So these are, you know, really specific kind of what are the biggest impacts that our company has, as well as what's material to our company. And they vary a lot from industry to industry. So thinking through what are the industries that you want to focus on would be really helpful to you in focusing your research and building your subject matter expertise in preparation for a career. Fourth is the one that's probably most important to the companies, to the employers, and that's what do you want to do for the company? So what's your role going to be? Are you going to be a sustainability manager, or are you going to be a data analyst? Are you going to be a finance manager? Are you going to be a business development manager? What's your role in the organization? And this is where you really have to think about what are the skills you're bringing, what's the functional skill set that you have, and how you map that to your career. And the last question is geography. So this was a much more critical question to ask before the pandemic. Now we have definitely seen a lot of employers being a lot more flexible on geography. It used to be that corporate sustainability roles were 98% of the time, you know, I'm just making that up, but it was like a high percentage of the time that they were based at the company headquarters with little to no flexibility. Today, I'm seeing lots of jobs posting where the location is flexible, or the company might give you a choice of, you know, 3 or 10 or, you know, certain number of office locations to work from. But it is still worth being realistic about if you have a geographic constraint to your search, what's that going to do in terms of who you realistically can work for? So that's sort of one starting point for thinking through the options. The next is a matrix here that might help you think about this in another way, sort of more evaluative way. So on the one hand, if we think about this as going to be a 2x2 matrix, you could first think about what's the type of organization I want to work for. Do I want to work for what I'm calling a traditional MBA employer? So that's a, you know, an investment bank, a management consulting firm, a tech company, you know, a large multinational, or do I want to work for an organization where sustainability is part of its core product or service? So that's a company that is selling an environmental product or a clean energy product, or it's an environmental NGO, it's a sustainability consulting firm, it's where it's part of the core mission of the organization. On the other axis, you can use those same two labels to think about your role. So do you want to have a traditional kind of MBA role, which is a brand manager, financial analyst, you know, type of title? Or do you want working on sustainability to be your day job? So do you want to be working on environmental and social issues as part of your primary responsibility in the organization? And I would argue there are great opportunities for you to have a sustainability career in all four of these quadrants. So even in the traditional space, again, these are real examples of alumni, you can find really great opportunities to leverage your passion and your concern for sustainability issues and make a change from within the business where the business decisions are being made. So that's the traditional box. And the lower corner here, the traditional working in a sustainability oriented role in a traditional company. I think that's one that a lot of students focus on and certainly is an exciting and interesting place to work. Some of the pros and cons, I would say, one is that you're gonna be working in a sustainability oriented team. But the mission of the company, the larger mission, is not sustainability related. So you're going to be spending a lot of your time persuading, educating, convincing stakeholders that sustainability is material to the business, is essential, it's relevant. Often you're going to be persuading people where you don't have direct authority. So even in a company where you have the support of the CEO, if sustainability is not the core mission of the business, you're still going to have to be kind of constantly like educating your investors, your consumers, your business line managers about why sustainability is the right decision, where it makes sense for the business, how it fits in with the business case of the organization. The upside is that you have a huge potential for scale in this type of role. So when, you know, a company like Gap or like Walmart makes a sustainability change, it has a huge impact in terms of absolute impact, right? Versus a smaller company that might make a change, even if their change is, you know, relatively more progressive, it's not going to have the same kind of ripple effects through supply chains as those big company actions. So, you know, some sustainability practitioners love that. Like they love the potential to have this huge influence. And they're also okay with the fact that they are going to be, you know, spending a lot of their time still kind of educating, persuading, making the case for sustainability. The flip side of this, on the other side of our matrix here, the sustainability oriented organizations, you know, what the professionals will say is, it's refreshing not to have to justify your work, right? It's refreshing to be in an organization where everybody gets it. Like everyone is on board with the mission. Everyone is trying to make the world a better place, you know, no matter what their job function is. Everything you do, even if you're in a role that you're not working on sustainability directly yourself, if you're working for a sustainability-oriented organization, then you ultimately are having an impact on that mission too. So, you know, the shorthand for this is, do you want to make a green company big or do you want to make a big company green? It's kind of one way to think about it. And there's no right or wrong answer here. It's just more about your personal satisfaction. Like what's the environment you're going to thrive in? What's the culture you want to work in? Where you're going to be most excited to put your skills to work. So let me spend a few minutes here talking about some more of the tactical job search strategies, and then I will get to Q&A. So maybe 10 minutes here to talk about the job search. So first is embrace the diversity of your background. A lot of the students that I work with are career changers, and it can be really daunting to think like, well, I did this before, and now I'm trying to make a complete pivot into a new industry, a new function. But what I have found in interviewing practitioners who are working, you know, not just in corporate sustainability roles, but in sustainability consulting or environmental conservation or impact investing, is that many of those professionals come from all kinds of different backgrounds, right? There's not a linear ladder-like progression in any of these fields. And some of these fields are so new that the jobs are just being created now. Or if you're a current student, the job you might take, you know, a year and a half from now by graduation may not even exist yet. So you might be part of writing that job description. Most practitioners will say that working on sustainability issues, it requires collaboration and understanding of what's happening in policy, in government, in the NGO space, and in business. And so any piece of that story that you can tell is helpful. It's just about how you tell that story to explain what aspects of your background are most relevant to these careers. So in order to do that, one strategy is to focus on your transferable skills. So, you know, maybe what you did before grad school is not at all like what you're going to, but there are elements of it that are transferable. Did you manage a team? Did you manage a project? Did you manage budgets and schedules? Did you do data analytics? Did you do a lot of writing, communication? did you do a project that had an element of strategy to it? And it was in a totally different context, but you could still pull out the story about how that strategy translated into organizational performance. So you're going to spend some time, if you're a career changer, thinking about what did I do before grad school? What elements of that can I say are skills that I'm going to bring with me to this new job post MBA? And then you're going to use your time during your MBA to fill any gaps on your resume. And gaps can be all kinds of different things. So this the framework I suggest to students is, you know, to start, a lot of your job search is going to be through informational interviewing, right? So you're going to be talking with as many people, as many practitioners as possible, and building your professional network. And when you're talking with those, whether they're alumni or they're people that you met at a virtual event or a conference or someone who came to speak on campus, if you're talking with them afterwards, you ask them for a coffee chat, you're talking with them and you ask, you know, what would make me an ideal candidate to join your team 2 years from now? I'm not asking you for a job right now. I just want to know, like, how would I get there in the future? And, you know, really try to get a good understanding. Like, what is that going to look like? What, my dream job, I need to have this many years of marketing experience, this type of internship, these type of personal skills, this type of subject matter expertise. What is it that would make you the perfect candidate for that dream job? And then, you know, what is it that I did before business school that I can use to check some of those boxes? And then how can I fill the rest of those gaps during my time as an MBA? So while you're in grad school, obviously you're building all your functional skills in your core MBA classes, but you're also taking electives that might be relevant that you can highlight on your resume, your clubs, your extracurriculars, the projects you do, the research projects, the independent studies. If you have an opportunity to work on like a consulting project as a student, you can use that to fill an experience gap. If you have opportunities to serve on a board or volunteer in a meaningful way with an organization, all of those are opportunities to fill some of those gaps. And clearly your summer internship is your biggest opportunity to fill an important gap on your resume too. When it comes to applying, you really need to understand, start with the question of what is driving this, the creation of this position or the hiring of this position. What does the employer need done? It's really important to kind of understand, especially in the sustainability world, what are the terms they're using? Are they using the term corporate citizenship? Are they using the term corporate social responsibility, ESG, sustainability, and why? What's behind their interest in this area? I have seen some students fall down because they tell a great story about how they're passionate about environmental issues, and then they find out afterwards that the company is really more interested in philanthropy or their employee engagement activities. And so there's suddenly a mismatch between the sort of environmental bent and the social bent of the job. So thinking about, you know, what does the employer need, and then how am I going to meet that need? That's how you want to frame your application and your conversations with that company. Passion is essential in this field. So I know that the first thing you're going to write in your cover letter is, I'm interested in this job because I am passionate about solving the problem of climate change or whichever issue area you're interested in. But you just know that everyone else is also going to share that passion, every other applicant. So it's really, it is important and essential that you come from a place of enthusiasm for the mission, but it's not gonna be sufficient to get you the interview or to get you the job. Just being passionate about it is not enough. The company wants to know, okay, but what can you do for me? And then to that end, how can you show them, don't just tell them that you're a good communicator or I can develop your marketing strategy. You need to show them I can develop your marketing strategy as evidenced by the fact that I have already you know, taken these classes, done these type of marketing projects, been the president of my marketing club. You know, what is the evidence that the show don't tell applies not only to your skills. So if you're going to tell them that you're good at something, you need to give an example that demonstrates that you're good at it. It also applies to your passion. So if you say you're passionate about the health of the oceans, then you should be prepared to say, like, I am a member of this organization, or I have done this volunteer work, or I have focused my academic studies, something that's going to demonstrate how you've taken some action on that passion rather than being sort of passively interested in it. And then be ready to make the business case for sustainability. So I have heard that this is still, you know, a possibility. We used to think this was much more of a priority in the early days of sustainability. But I believe that some employers are still asking questions along these lines. How do I convince my CFO, my investors, my customers, that investing in this XYZ sustainability initiative, even if it costs more, is good for our company? So you might be asked a question like that in an interview, or you might be asked to demonstrate enough understanding of the industry context, the materiality of sustainability issues, to make that case when you're talking with industry professionals. So just think some about that. It's not going to be the same business case for every company, and it's really not going to be the same business case from industry to industry. So that's where kind of understanding the industry lens and what's most relevant and material, you know, financially to companies makes a difference in how you come across in your interviews. So here are a few tips. You know, I'm often asked by alumni, I'm not working in sustainability now, but I would like to in the future, or by students who tell me, well, I've already committed to working for XYZ traditional employer, but eventually later in my career, I'd like to move into more of an impact-oriented career. So there are some ways you can clearly start thinking about how you make a difference and position yourself for a sustainability career farther down the line. You know, the first is, what can you do from within that current job that would fulfill your interests and get you involved with sustainability initiatives at your company? So if you're in marketing, like, can you influence the packaging decisions or the raw material decisions or the procurement decisions? You know, can, if you are working in finance, you know, can you volunteer to get involved with how the company responds to ESG investors? Can you bring up climate risk in the context of your current role? So thinking about what are the levers you might have in your current role to bring social and environmental impact into the conversation. And then try to find ways to build a little bit of that expertise from within your current role, even if you're in a kind of traditional business. And I have seen alumni do this, and then it goes so well that eventually they create a new opportunity, a new role for themselves within the organization. The other ways that you can think about this are to get involved in a more extracurricular way. So are you volunteering with local organizations? Can you volunteer with a nonprofit, not just on their stream cleanup or their habitat build, but could you volunteer in a meaningful way using your business skills? Could you help them write their financial plan, or could you help them with a new business development effort? So you could develop then sort of a project that you could cite as an example of some of your efforts. And then kind of keep your eye on the long-term goal. So your job search strategy, no matter whether you're a current student or you're an alum, is to be talking with as many people as possible. If you think about the 80-20 rule, we apply that here too. I say 80% of your job search time is networking, and 20% of it is actually applying, writing cover letters and resumes and submitting them. So 80% of your work is developing relationships, you know, building trust, building new industry contacts, learning enough about the space so that you're really well informed when it gets time to making that application. So thinking that about how those relationships you build now can have a long-term impact, whether that's for your first job post-MBA or whether that's further down the road. That's my slides in a nutshell. Let me pause now and open the Q&A, and we'll see how many of these we can get through before we run out of time. So let's see, here we go. For the MBA careers examples, do you think an MBA is critical in order to obtain these roles? And what kinds of certifications or skills are necessary when switching into the sustainability space? So the answer that you'll is it depends. It's really about where you're trying to get to and where you're starting from. So if you are looking at a job that maybe it says they prefer an MBA, but you read the job description and realize, well, they prefer an MBA, but it's really because it's a very finance heavy job. And you have some finance expertise, whether that's in your undergraduate degree or the work you're doing, it may not be necessary. Like, you may be just as strong a candidate without an MBA. On the other hand, you know, if you read a job description and it's very finance heavy, ESG investing heavy, and it says bachelor's degree and 3 years of experience and MBA preferred, then it's going to be hard if you were, for instance, I was an English major. So if you don't have any relevant, you know, undergraduate degree or work experience or grad school to make yourself stand out. So I really think it's got to be, you really have to do sort of an assessment of where am I trying to get to? Where am I now? And how far apart are those? Grad school, whether it's an MBA or a different degree, is a really great way to make a career change. So if you're looking to pivot, you know, grad school is a great way to tell a story. This is what I did before. Here's what I wanted to do afterwards. And here's why I have made these decisions about grad school, what I've learned, and how that helps me make the pivot. And so I think that's one of the most, you know, the biggest reasons that students go to grad school is to help them kind of build the skills in order to make a pivot. The other question, the part of the question was about certifications. And again, that also depends. But I will say that most employers, and I listened to a recruiter panel recently, and they talked about this as well, the certifications, if a company really wants you to be certified in something, they will send you to that certification. So if they need you to be certified, LEED certified, or have a GRI certification, they if they have you and they believe you're the right fit for the role, they can send you to that training later. So if you have the certifications already, you know, clearly cite them, but I don't think I would spend a ton of time and money and energy chasing them. And I would really try to understand through your informational interviews, you know, whether those are, you know, how strong of an asset they are. Here's another question that sounds like it potentially from a prospective student. How long do you recommend someone works between undergrad and pursuing an MBA? We have a pretty broad range. So, but the typical range for us here at Fuqua is 5.5 years. So the average daytime MBA student has 5.5 years of work experience before they come. We don't, I think, currently have an explicit work experience requirement, but I will say, as someone who's done a daytime MBA, that it was really incredibly beneficial for me to have worked in a role and then bring those learnings to the classroom and to also learn from my classmates about their experiences and their work experience before their MBA. So you'll see a broad range. There are a lot of programs that will have a specific requirement and some that will not. And then there are also executive MBA offerings, and those tend to be for more senior skilled experienced professionals who may have 10 plus years of experience. But there's a pretty broad range. For MBA students who came from traditional industries and roles, how do they position themselves as interested and knowledgeable about sustainability? So your extracurriculars and your electives are going to really play an important role. I mean, first is if your school has a net impact chapter or a club that's focused on social impact or sustainability, you know, to get involved with that club? Could you even take a leadership position? Could you help your club organize an event? Maybe you have a sustainability conference or speaker series. Maybe you have a sustainability center or equivalent at your university. Are there opportunities to get involved with them, work on research projects? Do you have an opportunity to take on a part-time internship type of project during the academic year, either for credit or for pay? Some employers will take a part-time intern during the academic semester. All of those are experiences that you can put way up at the top of your resume. So you're, as a student, your resume is going to start with education at the top. And right under MBA, you know, you list your concentration. If you have the opportunity clearly to get a concentration that's relevant in your program, some programs don't have that option. And then right under that, you can put your club activities, and you might even put some of your electives if they're not obviously apparent from your concentration. So you might say coursework in sustainable business strategy, energy markets and innovation, member of Net Impact Club, president of the Energy Club, whatever some of those extracurriculars are, so you get that really high up and in your resume. Some students also put any kind of internships or even consulting projects that they do as a student in the work experience section. So it'll come up there near the top and you'll write graduate student consultant. You know, it's clear that you do this as a student, but it's still a relevant experience and you can put a bullet point or two about the project there. Let's see, for job search strategies, a lot of these new sustainability jobs require 6+ years of sustainability experience. For example, how do you suggest we navigate these sort of expectations? Yeah, this has been really tricky. I think that a lot of employers are being a little optimistic right now because I have seen so many jobs posted saying they want someone with 10+ years of sustainability or ESG experience. And I will tell you that I probably could name all the people who have 10+ years of sustainability experience. It's not that huge of a community. Because it's a relatively new field. I think that some recruiters are going to be more flexible on that years of work experience requirement. But the key for you is to drill down in terms of what are they looking for you to do? And what makes you confident that you can do that? You know, it's not enough to say, like, I believe in my talent. You need to write it down in a compelling way. Maybe I don't have 6 years, but I have 3 years, plus I've done these extracurricular projects, plus I was promoted at a young age, or I was on a board, or I have taken on a, you know, part-time degree on, in addition to my work. So, you know, how are you going to convince them that you can do the job? So it's less about like checking a box of seniority and more about, can you do the job, right? And when they're asking for years of experience, they're looking for someone coming in with expertise who, you know, ideally who can jump in and actually knows enough about the material to start working right away versus someone that they may have to spend a longer time training or hasn't had as much exposure to the topic. So I think that's the strategy. So let me come down and take another question. Are there recommended job sites where I can find the most amount of job postings for sustainability careers? I am so glad you asked this because there's another section of my slide deck that I didn't share with you. It's the appendix. So let me share that again. After we're done, I will post these slides. And in the appendix, I have all these resources for you. Career trends, salary data, where to read sustainable business news. This one, Corporate Eco Forum, is my favorite, but there are a lot of great resources here. There's some books here, conferences, and then eventually job postings. So here are some of my favorite sites for sustainability related jobs. I will say, I really don't recommend that the strategy is that you spend a lot of time looking at job boards and then applying. Applying for jobs is not a numbers game. It's not the lottery. So there, it's not that you, the more jobs you apply to, the higher your probability of getting hired is. It's not that. So, you know, sometimes job seekers come in and tell me, well, I applied for 30 jobs last month. And I think, well, you just wasted your time because you could not have possibly done enough homework and known enough people and enough about the company to put in a really quality application for all of those opportunities. So it's better to be prepared to put in a really quality application based on your research and your understanding of the role. And hopefully in your networking, you even might meet some people within the organization who then can help pull your resume out and pull it to the top of the pile. But the one area that job boards can be really useful for is getting a better sense of career landscape. So if you're still in the exploring phase and you're like, I don't really understand what it would mean to be an ESG data analyst, right? So you can look at some of these job postings and read more than the title, like really read down to the very fine print at the bottom where they talk about the duties as well as what they're looking for in candidates. And think honestly about, does that sound like something I would enjoy doing? Does that sound like something that I would have a case for being a good fit for? So I think, you know, there's a lot to be gained by looking at job boards, but I really would not go down the rabbit hole of spending all your time looking at job boards. But I do have all these resources for you, and I'm happy to share the slide deck afterwards, and I'll put it in the YouTube event description, and you can download it, share it with your friends as well. Another question, can you repeat what the recommended 80 to 20 time allocation pertained to? 80% of your time focused on your networking and informational interviews, 20% of your time focused on applying. If you're not familiar with this term, informational interview, it's kind of a career coach insider term, but it really just means building a relationship, having coffee with someone, networking, you know. So if you are interested in learning more about a particular field, alumni who are working in that field, your school could probably help you with introductions, your existing network. If you are a current MBA student, you could rely both on your MBA school's network, alumni network, as well as your undergraduate school's alumni network. Who can you find who's working in that space? Can you send them a polite email telling them about yourself? I'm interested in learning more about this career path. Would you have 20 minutes to speak with me by phone or by Zoom? Setting up that call, having done really great research on what that organization is, what that person does, and then have a conversation. I would love to learn a little bit more, you know, about you, things that I cannot find on the website. So I've read about what you do. Can you tell me more about like what is the most rewarding thing about your career? What direction is your team going in? What do you find challenging? What skills are you using most? Is it a very quantitative job versus a qualitative one? If I wanted to be a great candidate for your organization down the road, what would make me really stand out? What are you looking for? That's those type of questions. Not asking them in your informational interview for an internship or for a job. So just learning from them. You might ask them, can I stay in touch with you? Can we be connected on LinkedIn? And then when you're done with your informational interview, you're going to follow up. You're going to send an email, not a form email. Okay. We all know when it's a form email, everyone knows, and it immediately like casts a pall over the conversation. So you're going to write a genuine thank you email. Thank you for your time. I learned so much from our conversation. In particular, I'm going to follow up on these three things that you recommended. And I am really excited about learning more about this space. Then you might follow up with them later. You know, I've taken your advice. I started listening to that podcast you recommended. It's terrific. I've learned this. I've really, you know, now have decided to focus my job search more on this type of role. If you have any other advice for me as I go forward, or you think there's someone in your organization that I should speak to, I'm actively looking for internships at this time. So, you know, this is about building relationships. If you do recruiting on campus, it's a very transactional experience. You know, you have an interview with a recruiter, it's a yes or no, and then that relationship's over. But when you're doing these informational interviews, this networking, you're really building your professional network for life. So some of those people, you may not feel like it's immediately productive. They don't offer you a job right on the call, but you know, the deeper you go into the field that you're interested in, the more those relationships are going to come up and continue to be valuable. So those are people that are going to be in your professional network as you move through your career. So they might be, you know, your customers or your consultants or your, you know, someone you call for advice once you're in your full-time job. They might be your second or third employer after business school. So I think there are a lot of possibilities. You need to kind of mentally, you know, prepare yourself that 80% of this job search work is about talking with people and take the leap, you know, put yourself out there, be open to learning rather than just asking them for a job. Sometimes it's uncomfortable. If you're currently a student, you can talk with your career center and ask them to help you prep or practice for those type of calls. But that's where you're really going to have the most return on your investment. And those people want to talk to you too, because they realize that you are someone who's going to be immediately in a year or two, you're going to be working in the industry that they're working in. And you're going to be, you know, a talented contributing professional that they want in their circles too. So it's not a one-way benefit here. It's, you know, it's a benefit to them too, as long as you treat it with respect and you do the research and you try not to be too extractive about the conversation. So I know we have other questions here. I hope that I have gotten to some of the most relevant ones. I'm really glad that you could join us today. We're about out of time. So I wanna wrap up and just let you know that, you know, it's an exciting time to be in this space. I hope that all of you will stick with it. I hope that you will pursue your interest, because the world needs you right now. We need more great, talented young professionals working on sustainability, climate, decarbonization, water, education, environmental justice, poverty, social impact, all of the sustainable development goals. We need your talent and your time and your inspiration, your energy working in these fields. So I hope that you'll find your pathway to a meaningful career in this space, and let us know if we can help you at Duke. Thanks.